What's going on, guys? It has been a minute. I don't remember the last time I did a live. Yeah, man. Missed you. Did you miss me? That's what you get for doing a swing shift for the last week straight, that 4 to midnight. But still got you guys some cases of the day last week. We just couldn't describe them live, but hopefully you enjoyed my little nightly rounds at like 11 p.m. or something. Anyway, how have you guys been? Before we get started with all this, what's new with you all? Appreciate everybody, by the way, who's been sending me those medical-related images. Anybody know what I posted this morning, by the way? That needle-looking thing, right? On that video in the morning when I tried to show somebody up because everybody showed me up. Studying for midterms, that sucks. I wish I had it in front of me right now. I showed you guys a biopsy gun. It was a BioPence gun. Give me 1 second here. I gotta show it to you. Cause why not, right? All right. So yeah, basically I'd shown a, this is a BioPence. This is basically a workhorse biopsy needle for what we do in interventional radiology. This gets us some pretty good core samples. You can take anywhere, it's kind of adjustable right here from anywhere from like a millimeter to 3 millimeters. So it's pretty cool. It's got a little firing mechanism back here and you can cock the device. If I can do it with one hand, I kind of did try not to like take a biopsy out of my own finger here. So you can cock the device like this. And then once you press it down, it's ready to go. And then you insert it. We usually do this with ultrasound. In real time, get to wherever we need, whether it be a liver, a kidney, whatever it is. And then you just take the biopsy up top. You just press this button. It's got the safety on. And then it takes the sample. Anyway, that's what it was. It was a BioPence needle. It's the workhorse for our biopsy kits in interventional radiology. Let's get to case of the day. What exactly were we looking at today? Does anybody have any guesses as to what this, first of all, what body part were we looking at? It wasn't the leg or anything like that, it was the arm, right? And then, so let's kind of break it down for what age group is this patient, right? Because every time we're dealing with radiology, we always want to know what age group we're looking at, and that actually sways our diagnosis one way or the other. So if you look at the exam, right? So this is the arm, this is the elbow over here, this is the wrist up here, and then this is your radius and ulna over here, right? So you gotta figure out now what age group is this, because again, it's gonna affect our diagnosis and it'll affect our management. So looking at the elbow, let's start down here, we can see that there are some areas that haven't exactly joined up or ossified together, right? So it's not, when you look at a baby, you probably won't even see this here. You'll see like little tiny specks of ossification. So this is not a baby, but it's also not an adult, and it's somewhere in between. Let's just leave it at that, right? Over here as well, this is not fused. So in an adult, you will not see this right here, this line right here, this will all be fused together. So again, this is some sort of child. We can ballpark it, I don't know, 10 years old, something like that, right? So then you have to figure out what type of fractures do children get that adults don't really get. And yes, I'm already leading you down the path of fractures because this was a fracture. A lot of people got it, but when you're thinking about a child, you have to think about a certain type of fracture because children's bones are very elastic. And then when they fall with like an outstretched hand, something like that, or they fall with their arm straight down, the axial loading of that arm, the axial loading of the hand and the wrist will cause a buccal fracture, or also known as a torus fracture. So green stick fracture is a little bit different. So a buccal fracture, AKA torus fracture, it's kind of synonymous. Torus fracture technically is like a circumferential buccal fracture. But a buccal fracture is basically if you're tracing the cortex and then you see just a little tiny bulge of the cortex and then you go back down again, that's what it is. It's an incomplete fracture of usually this area and the diaphysis area, metaphysis in children. So here's the zoomed in version right here, all right? So you're kind of tracing it and you're like, it's actually seen better on, you can kind of see it here. So if I'm tracing this, I'm tracing it, all of a sudden I see this little bulge right here and then I go back down. So that's a buccal fracture right there. And then this is the zoomed out version. You can kind of see it right. Where's my finger? Right there. So it's bulging a little bit right there. And then if you're really keen, you can kind of look. Here's a zoomed in version right here. You can kind of see the sharp angle right here, right? It's kind of a sharp angle. I don't like that either. And if you look on this side as well, on this ulnar aspect right here, this is kind of a sharp angle right here as well. So you have a buccal fracture or a torus fracture in the distal radius, and then you have some incomplete kind of sharp angling in the distal ulna as well. So this is very, very, very common for little kids, for 10 years old, 5, 10 years old, whatever it is. Kids are notorious for getting buccal fractures. So remember this. If you have a patient coming into the emergency department, or if you're a radiology resident, anyone, pediatrician, and you're looking at these plain films, you have to assess for these buccal fractures. The other thing that I wanted to talk to you about, oh, a green stick fracture. That's right, somebody mentioned, right? And a couple of people did ask about a green stick fracture. A green stick fracture, say if this part of the cortex were fractured, but it didn't extend all the way out to the other side. And the reason they call it a green stick fracture is, imagine you go into the forest and you take a green, literally a green stick off of the tree. It's not like super dried out or anything, right? And it's still got some moistness to it. It's still kind of living. And then you try to crack it. Well, one side of it will crack open, but the other side of it will remain intact. That's why they call it a green stick fracture, right? So remember that, remember when you're looking at these plain films to look for what, how old the patient is, and we figure that out, right? Because these are not ossified, everything's not joined together here yet, even down in the elbow, everything's not joined together. And then we talked about the buccal fracture, AKA torus fracture. The other things that people did talk about and they did answer were, let's talk about real quick, Galeazzi and Monteggia fractures, all right? These are fractures. So it's a Galeazzi. It's a weird mnemonic, and it's kind of a confusing mnemonic. And a lot of people hear the word mugger, M-U-G-R, and they think of these two fractures. But then it's really confusing as to which part is fractured, which part is dislocated. The one that I usually like to think about, the mnemonic, it's kind of weird and it's kind of morbid, but it's a gruesome murder, okay? G-U-R capitalized, GRU. And then murder, M-U-R capitalized, okay? So those are, that's the kind of, the capitalized portions are gonna describe what the fracture is, and then whatever, gruesome murder is just the way to remember it. So Galeazzi, if you remember it, so gruesome, G-R, and then the second letter is actually what was fractured. So G-R, so radius is fractured, and then the third letter, which is a U, is gonna be which part is dislocated. So G stands for what the fracture name is, R stands for what's fractured, U stands for what is actually dislocated. So gruesome, Galeazzi, I'm already confusing myself, radius fracture, ulnar dislocation. Then you go to Monteggia, and this is all distally at the wrist, okay? The wrist aspect will be dislocated. And then you go to a Monteggia fracture, so murder. Remember, M, the first letter is what it's actually called, and then U is actually, the second letter is what's fractured, and then R is what's dislocated. So murder in that order. So remember that. If you wanna try using the mnemonic, what did I say, mugger, you can try it. It just doesn't make sense to me. It's hard to remember what's fractured and what's dislocated. So that's a little bit about those. We talked about that. Some people answered that. What else? Any other questions you guys have about, oh, my quick and dirty rule for figuring out fractures on plain film, doesn't matter what age, imagine this, okay? Imagine you have a marble. Everybody remembers what a marble is, right? I haven't used one in God knows how long. What do people even use marbles for anymore, right? So imagine getting a marble, and imagine starting the marble right here and just rolling it down the cortex. So you're rolling this the marble down the cortex, or from here up, doesn't matter. And you want to figure out where the marble will actually jump a little, or where it will get deflected off a little. So imagine that in your mind's eye. I promise you that will help you find fractures. So this is a perfect example. Imagine, you know, the patient's supine or the arm's down. It's obviously not anti-gravity or something, right? So you're rolling the marble and you're rolling it, you're rolling it, you're rolling it. And you can see that the marble is going to kind of hit this little notch right here, and the trajectory is going to be weird and it might pop off. And then imagine rolling a marble down here. You can imagine this little buckle right here. The marble is going to hit this, and it's going to like, what? My finger went the other way. And it's going to pop off that way, right? So that's kind of what I do in my mind. I'm imagining, all right, do I really think this thing is buckled or not? Well, let me do my little stupid marble trick. And then I do that, and I'm like, oh, yeah, the marble actually deflected and went off somewhere. And then I'm going to commit myself. I'm going to say, yeah, this is probably a fracture. What else? You guys got anything for me? There wasn't too much on this case. We went over, for anybody who's just joining, we went over the buccal fracture, aka torus fracture. We went over Monteggia and Galeazzi fractures. The mnemonic is gruesome murder. It's morbid, I get it, but it actually really helps for figuring out what fracture is which. What questions can I answer for you guys? It's been a while. And then anybody else who just joined, I saw or showed you guys this in the morning. This is a workhorse for interventional radiology. It's a biopsy needle. This is what gets us all our samples, a little firing mechanism up here. You just gotta cock it from here. If I can do it one-handed without taking my eye out. Oh, come on, I can do this, right? There we go. So it's cocked now. And then as I bring it down, and then I can fire it up here. And the safety's on. Okay. Tips on how to estimate age on plain film. Oh, that's a good question. You have to see a bunch. You have to see a bunch of plain films. You have to know what, and to kind of break it down, you just go like, negative five. That's weird. You go from five and under, that's the way I do it. Like five and under, maybe eight and under. And then I do like, you know, 10 to 15. And then I'm like 18 and above. And when you're at 18 and above, the physes are all usually fused, but you can kind of get a hint of the physes still present. When you're at a baby level, everything, like it's a lot of soft tissue. You just see little tiny bones and then just soft tissue everywhere. You don't really see joints that well because it's just all soft tissue and cartilage at that point, or non-ossified areas. You just gotta see a lot. You just keep hammering home different plain films. Any other questions? Thanks guys for tuning in. Appreciate it as always. Again, it's been a while, but we're gonna get these back going. As always, until next time, you guys want to pick this up tomorrow. I'll get you a good case of the day tomorrow. Until then, hey, thank you. Appreciate you guys. Later.